first for attending here in person and joining us on Zoom as well. And I express RAS Korea's sincere gratitude to the Asia Development Foundation for its continued financial support. And we also thank our member, Ms. Lee, from Lee, for helping us with this wonderful event tonight. We are cordially reminded that the lecture content does not necessarily reflect the opinions and traditions of the Royal Asia Society Korea. Tonight, we have a lecture number 1502, and we'll be hearing from Mr. Matt VanVolkenburg, right here on stage, on the experimental artists and their complications for conformity in Korea. Matt first arrived in Korea back in 2001, and in 2005, you can hear me okay, right?
Yeah.
And in 2005, began his blog, Gust of Popular Feeling, where he has written about modern Korean history, urban redevelopment, and media depictions of foreigners. He contributed research to a case brought before the United Nations, which ultimately ended HIV testing of foreign English speakers in Korea. He's received an MA in Korean Studies from the University of Washington, where he began researching the development and suppression of youth culture in 1970s Korea. He's also the co-author, with along with David Dollinger, Called by Another Name, a memoir of the Gwangju Uprising. Matt is also a longtime member of the Royal Asia Society of Korea and one of the officers of the organization. So let's give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. It's nice to see so many people here tonight. Tonight I'm going to be talking about a small group of artists who came to prominence in Seoul between 1967 and 1970, and they ultimately came together as the fourth group between June and August 1970. But they had been active in Korea's art scene since the early 1960s. So starting from December 1967, a number of them began to perform a type of art known as happenings. And it was through these happenings and other provocative activities that they began to both reach out to and comment upon Korean society. Now, I'm not really interested in analyzing them so much as just looking at who they were, what they did, what they said about what they did, and what others said about it, including the news media, who played an important role in spreading their artwork and their messages. So the term happening was coined by the American artist Alan Kaprow in the late 1950s after he became interested in the performative aspects of making art. For Kaprow, the line between art and life was to be as fluid and indistinct as possible. And many of these ideas were influenced by the World War I era Dada movement and also the ideas of composer John Cage, among others. So in Korea, some of the earliest experimental groups were formed in 1962. So these artists were of a generation that had grown up under Japanese rule, had lived through World War II, the Korean War, and the student protests that overthrew Isungman in 1960. And so the groups that were formed were the Origin, the Zero Group, and Non-Corporeal. And in 1967, Non-Corporeal folded, and a new group was founded by some of the members called Shinjun. And it was members of this group in particular that pursued happenings and other non-corporeal forms of art. So in December 1967, these three experimental art groups, whose members were mostly graduates of Hongik University and Seoul National University, held an exhibition at the Central Information Center Gallery in Sogongdong in central Seoul. And so this exhibition might have passed without much notice, but the artists from the Zero and Shinjun groups went out into the streets to have a silent protest, and they were picketing, and the signs said things like, "National development should actively promote the arts, and Korea has no contemporary art museums." So this march was cut short by the police, who took them to Jongno police station. We'll hear about this kind of thing again later. So one member of the Shinjun group who was noticed at this exhibition was Jeong Gang-ja, and her sculpture, Kiss Me, here drew quite a bit of attention at the time. And so she's quite important moving forward, as are the two people on either side of her, Gang-guk Chin and Jeong Chan-seung. And so we can see some of Gang and Cheng's work here. And Gang's work also included him demolishing it. But this exhibition is best remembered for hosting Korea's first ever happening, titled Happening with Plastic Umbrella and Candle. So this was performed by the Zero and Shinjung groups. And as it turns out, it was filmed. So we actually have a clip of it. This clip is from the KBS archives and appeared on the Modern Korea documentary, which was curated by Lee Tae-yong. And what we can't hear at the beginning is that they are, there's no sound, but they are singing the song Seya, Seya, Paran Seya, in which a bird is told to fly away before the cold weather comes. So we can watch this. Apparently, this trampling was accompanied by a lot of screaming as well. So this happening was described by its writer, Oh Kwang-soo, as a sort of criticism on civilization by comparing a plastic umbrella symbolizing the modern material civilization with candlelight symbolizing our spirit, and finally breaking and trampling the umbrella. So when the performance ended, a participant said, "You should abandon the idea of drawing any associations with reality from this performance. To experience for yourself this beautiful phenomena that arise from chance acts and collisions with objects is the whole purpose of being here." So one media outlet did celebrate this exhibition and lauded the unconventional courage of the fearless generation. But those kind of expressions of support were pretty rare. There was a second happening on May 2nd, 1968, held at the Saesibon Music Room in downtown Seoul, which was titled Feast of Colored Vinyl. But I couldn't find any photos of it. The participants were Gang-guk Jin and Jeong Chan-seung, and it was intended to express the repressed desires and boredom of modern people. The third happening, on the other hand, is far better known. It was organized by the Korean Federation of Young Artists and held at Saesibon again on May 30th, 1968. And it was titled Transparent Balloons and Nude, and about 300 people attended this. So as the Joseon Ilbo described it, I found that they had the best, most detailed description. Young people blow up and attach red rubber balloons, perhaps to the stage, this isn't quite clear. And then artist Jeong Gang-ja comes out wearing an undershirt and tights and sits on a chair. And young people make and attach transparent balloons to her shoulders, arms, chest, and stomach. In the middle of this, the woman's shirt and tights are sliced open with a knife, revealing her upper body and her underwear. The transparent balloons continue to be attached to her entire body, which is, quote, submerged in transparent balloons like being buried in a large soap bubble. So music like that of John Cage's plays, and blue, red, and yellow lights are projected. Finally, the half-naked woman stands up and the artists press down on the transparent balloons against her body to break them, causing the woman to leave and the work to disappear. And so the balloons being discussed here are not rubber balloons. I don't know how many of you would remember these. I haven't seen these in a long time. Are they still around or? Okay. Because I took this photo in 2006, but it's basically a little container of rubber cement type stuff. And you put a tube into it, a plastic tube, and then blow on it and it inflates this. And they're very kind of sticky. They stick to each other and they're very flimsy. So I'm quite certain this is what was used in this happening. So following the happening, there was a seminar where art critic Yujun Sung discussed how to appreciate contemporary art. And the participants interpreted the show as a joint realization of behavioral expressive art and environmental art. So Jeong Chan-seung, described as a key member of the group, dismissed the general feeling that it was a risky endeavor and stated that happenings allowed for total participation in such a way that the artist is once the subject, the ingredient, and the appreciator. He added, even if we should become forbidden to express ourselves by laws of this country, we will continue when we are so inclined. We will choose to be punished rather than cutting ourselves short of expressing what is in our feelings. So how was this received? The Korea Times wrote rather mockingly, oh, it was happening, all right, and described the artists as bizarre. The Junong Ilbo described it as a work by cultural terrorists who use plastic balloons instead of canvas and paint on the naked body of a young woman. That paper also described Baek Nam-jun as a Korean avant-garde artist who works in New York and called him another cultural terrorist. And the Weekly Hanguk also brought up the fact that Baek Nam-jun had been arrested a year earlier in New York City along with Charlotte Moorman, who was playing the cello while topless. So the Weekly Hanguk also focused on Jung's nudity and asked how she felt about it. And she said, my desire to make this work was greater than my shame. It also noted that on the evening of May 4th, they reenacted Transparent Balloon and Nude on TBC TV, where she was alone without a crowd and wearing a swimsuit. And this is the only, yeah, I'd never come across that anywhere else. So the fourth happening was Murder by the Han River on August 17th, 1968, under the Yonghua Bridge. And so this was performed by Gangguk Jin, Jeong Gang-ja, and Jeong Chan-seung. And one report suggested that of the 50 or so people watching, 40 of them were reporters. Of course, this was a pretty negative review, so I don't know. Another review said there were about 100 people, so that's unclear. So what happened was each of the three participants dug a pit big enough to fit their own body and buried themselves while covered in a colored piece of plastic. And then after being showered in water by the spectators, they rose from the ground and wrote on the plastic the words, cultural fraud, culturally blind, cultural shirkers, illegal amasser of culture, cultural peddler, and cultural contortionist, which referred to those who blindly follow the aesthetics of the time. So according to the Seoul Shinmun, while two people distributed blank notes to the audience, another took the plastic and burned it. Then the accusations written by the audience were collected and read one by one and thrown into the fire. And then the burnt remains were buried under the bridge. So the Joseon Ilbo wrote that the citizens were watching just stared in disbelief, while according to the Hanguk Ilbo, one audience member grumbled, I came because I heard the woman was taking off her clothes, but she didn't take them off and it was cold, so it wasn't fun. While another audience member next to them went, you're culturally blind. So as the Seoul Shinmun put it, the young people who break away from the canvas explained that the purpose of the happening show was to rebel against the conservative climate of the art world and denounce the cultural reality of the older generation. And I should note that after this, Gangguk Jin, who's pictured here, he founded a design studio in Myeongdong, and so he stopped his art activities for the next 4 years. So we won't really be seeing him again. So the next appearance of one of these artists in the media was in November 1968 in the magazine Sunday Seoul, which published photos of Jeong Gang-ja undergoing body painting while mostly naked, and which was titled From Mini Skirts to Nude Look. It also published a profile of Jeong Gang-ja titled My Nudity is a Raw Material for Artwork, the words of the happening goddess Jeong Gang-ja, who enjoys taking off her clothes. As she put it, a happening is the liberation of expression and materials, so the nude is just a byproduct of this. I'm willing to take off my clothes if I'm used as a material for a work of art. And this profile appeared only 2 months after Sunday Seoul was first published. Such weekly magazines had mostly come onto the scene in 1968. Prior to this, there was only the weekly Hanguk. But in the second half of 1968, five more weekly magazines appeared because the economy had grown enough and there was a market for this. And these magazines were always on the hunt for salacious or shocking content and were happy to publish articles about avant-garde artists, especially those who remove their clothes. It should be noted, I mean, I'm using these as a source a lot of the time, but you know, some of these stories need to be taken with a grain of salt. Quite a few of their articles are perhaps creative writing projects. So that needs to be remembered. So body painting was also the focus of an article about artist Kim Gurim published by Weekly Woman in May 1969. The body painting he did was highlighted with painted plastic, metal, and jewelry to create a harmonious and unified whole. So this was done with six models to decorate a work that walks on the street. So Kim Gurim is an interesting person because unlike the other artists I've been discussing, he didn't graduate from university. He did spend some time in an art program in Gyeongsangbuk-do, but he dropped out because he thought it was boring. So he was mostly self-taught, and for that, some people looked down on him. But he was drawn to modern art because one day he was in a bookstore and he came across magazines that showed the kind of modern art, like Jackson Pollock, that was gaining traction in the U.S. And he asked the bookstore owner, "So where did you get this magazine?" And he said, "Oh, the U.S. base." And so, as he says in his interview, I taught myself from Life and Time magazine. And also, we saw on this pamphlet that this 1962 exhibition was held at the USIS, or the United States Information Service Art Gallery. So there's another American connection there too. So 10 days before the body painting profile in Weekly Woman, the Weekly Kyunghyun published the article, "Korean Happening Group Makes Nude Movies. An avant-garde film that doesn't need a screen has appeared in Seoul. The film is not projected onto a screen, but onto a stage formed by objects like a theater stage, which itself is an avant-garde work of art. Their intention is to try to create a kind of visual beauty using three-dimensional space. They argue that the film is only part of the environmental artwork and does not exist by itself." So this 20-minute film titled Civilization, Woman, and Money was an 8mm film, and it was directed by Kim Gurim, written by Che Won Young, and featured art objects by Jeong Chan-seung and Jeong Gang-ja. And the article said, "These young avant-garde flag bearers are willing to try anything that is considered an abomination because of their youth." And so the film apparently involved nudity, masturbation, and apparently sex as well, all shown in disconnected scenes. And he said he was actually, in a more recent interview, he was influenced by the number of young women who ended up coming to Seoul and getting tricked into prostitution. But the magazine said, "Unfortunately, announcement of this groundbreaking first Korean experimental film has been postponed because they consider it a failure, and a new experimental film is in the works." And this film would be shot with Jeong Chan-seung and Jeong Gang-ja. And it described this new film as being about human beings who have lost their sense of direction in the mechanized modern world. So the film they described in this article is clearly the meaning of 1/24th of a second, which of course is a reference to there being 24 frames of film per second. And Kim Gurim screened this film at the Academy Theater in Gwanghwamun on July 21st, 1969. And we can see here the cover of the pamphlet, which is quite artistically designed. And Also, there's a photo of how it was projected onto his body at the screening. But as Jihoon Suk recently pointed out to me, a splice on the film broke while passing through the projector, so the screening was cut off halfway through. So it was never shown fully and actually languished for 30 years until 2001. And at that time, it was transferred to video, but unfortunately afterwards, the original film was lost. But this has been preserved. I'm not going to show the whole thing. It's about 9 minutes, but I'm going to show about 5 minutes of it. Now, of course, the thing to remember is that when it was first screened, it was projected, as I said, like onto his body. So this is on the Chengde Expressway, which at that time would have only been about a year old. Of course, it was demolished in 2003. That's Jeong Gang-ja there.
originally sound or music that accompanied this?
During the performance, yeah, there would have been, but we don't know what that was. I guess we'll stop there. So as the film magazine Yonghwa Japji described it, according to this article, Kim Garim said, "This avant-garde film is not necessarily a movie. In other words, it is a total art in which poetry, music, art, film, and dance coexist with equal and independent value. And while crying out for the liberation of techniques of expression, it destroys the tradition of the past." So the next article to feature a member of the group is a weekly Kyunghyang profile of Jeong Gang-ja, which noted that she had disappeared from public a month prior to focus on her artwork, in part because people thought she only takes off her clothes. She revealed that she and five other Korean artists were invited to take part in an exhibition in Tokyo that December. And then the article sort of delved into her personal life, describing her apartment in detail, and most of this because she was a single woman. She was renting a room in Mapo where she lived and taught art to 10 or 20 elementary school students in the afternoons. But then they asked her questions like, "When will you get married? Oh, marriage is boring. Are you a lesbian? Shh, that sounds like trouble." And then she announced, "At the end of next year, I will move to the US where my aunt lives. I need to make a name for myself internationally, and Korea is too small." So the article also shows the artwork she was going to display in Tokyo. And she said, "From breasts to anus, it symbolizes the female libido. And when electrified, the water would flow from the nipples into the hole at the bottom, the anus." So it's all very whimsical. She would later title it "A Woman's Spring," as in a spring of water. Also worth noting at this time is Korea's first international modern music festival, the Seoul Musica Nova, which took place from September 5th to 7th, 69. And was held mostly at the National Theater. The event was sponsored by Baek Nam-jun, Kang Seok-hee, Park Jun-sang, and Yoon Hee-sung, but Yoon dropped out eventually. If we remember, Yoon Hee-sung was kidnapped by the KCIA from West Germany in 1967 because he had visited North Korea. The festival was to perform music by these musicians, as well as people like Karlheinz Stockhausen and John Cage and others. Not everyone received the festival well. Longtime RAS member Alan Heyman thought the offerings were noisy and by and large uninteresting, with the exception of Kang Seok-hee and Park Jun-sang's compositions. He wrote of John Cage, "Surely the man must be completely out of his mind," and criticized the fact that most performances had to rely on electronic blares, flashing lights, and abstractions projected onto a screen. But that's interesting because it gives us an idea of what this was like. He also wrote that he asked a high school girl sitting nearby what she thought of the very strange avant-garde music. Her reply was only that this was her very first encounter with this type of music. She did not say, however, whether it would be her last. So the most eye-opening piece was to be Composition for Piano by Baek Nam-jun, during which, the Korea Times said, "Theater music lovers will appreciate two pairs of feet, one a man's and the other a woman's, beating on the piano keyboard, though it was feared it could be labeled as pornography or a happening show." This was because the couple was supposed to be naked, underneath a sheet. And as the Sunday Soul pointed out, that's their underwear on the piano bench. But it also pointed out that one of the actors was Jeong Chan-seung, the star of the film. So in October, Jeong Chan-seung and designer Son Il-gwang invited the magazine Sunday Soul to accompany them as they had their hair cut by a hairdresser rather than a barber. And Han Dae-soo, who shocked Koreans with his long hair when he returned to Korea in 1968, said of Chung, "When I first met him in the late 1960s, his hair was not that long, so I think I maybe influenced him." So Chung and Son decided to rebel against barbershops because the barbers wouldn't cut their hair the way they wanted. They would just go in and they would ask to have it cut and they would just be ignored. So as Jung put it, "We've all been reduced to cogs in the machine. Individuality is dying." And he added, "It's not just about hairstyles, but also about dressing and thinking. And if you want to have a personal life, you have no choice but to challenge existing stereotypes." It should be noted that other than articles mentioning Han Dae-soo, this is the first article I've seen that mentions, you know, men having long hair in Korea. And this is October, so by November 1970, the weekly Kyunghyun would report on the long-haired trend among men, a new fashion revolution spreading from rock musicians and other entertainers to the younger generation and even middle-aged men. Also, unlike earlier happenings that had occurred as planned events where the media had been invited, in this case, Sunday Soul's participation and the publication of this story was integral to this event. Otherwise, it wouldn't even be known. And so this coverage was clearly solicited by the artists themselves, since it was a way to get their message to a far larger audience than you might find in an exhibition hall. And in a way, the magazines became the unwitting co-conspirators in these artists' attempt to reach a larger audience. An example of this would be the mail art project undertaken by Kim Gurim and Kim Cha-sup in October 1969, a work titled Artifact of Mass Media. This was reported in the weekly Kyunghyun, which described it as the bizarre art by happening artists. And as the article described it, the artists sent three strange letters to 100 cultural figures over the course of a week. So one letter contained half of a piece of paper with only Kim Gurim's fingerprint on it, while the other contained Kim Cha-sup's fingerprint on the matching half of the piece of paper. And then the third letter that followed contained the title of the work on a card reading, "You appreciated the artifact of mass media a day ago," and it had both of their names on it. So the first and the second letters had to be combined to form a single work of art. And now there was a precedent for mail art sort of in the American art community, though it was pretty obscure. So dismissed as a prank by some, the artists declared the fingerprints were chosen because they could not be imitated by humans or computers. As well, they noted, up until now, artworks have always been made using canvas or objects to force the audience to look at them in the exhibition hall, and mailing letters was a way around this. They added that one day the printed media of letters will disappear, so the letter will remain a relic. And the magazine asked, "Is your mental state sound? Does anyone around you call you crazy?" They responded, "People who are ahead of their time are always seen as crazy by the foolish crowd." So on April 11th, 1970, after distributing leaflets explaining his plan, the location, and the time, Kim Gurim, aided by Jeong Chan-seung, burned five triangles into a 100 meter long and 20 meter high slope near Hanyang University. While doing this, Kim sustained minor burns, but completed the task successfully. And notice that's not water. I think he's carrying gasoline and sprinkling it. So he clearly, got his hand burned at one point. So Kim's leaflet described the work as a call for a new artistic modernity, and further read, "The lawn will burn and leave a trace, but over time the trace of the burn spot will disappear as the grass grows back. So here we recognize a subtle visual statement. that combines time, space, and action, that a work of art can be made without mass or volume. He also discussed how destruction was an inherent part of creation. So two different weeklies published articles about this, with the weekly Kyunghyang being rather critical. It criticized Kim's avant-garde art, which reeks of showmanship, and described how the police showed up and just laughed hysterically and left. So there's an excerpt of the interview here. How much money did it cost? It cost me about 20,000 won, which is about 500,000 won today. Do you feel like it was a waste of money? I never thought about that. How can you make pure art while thinking about money? Have you ever had a job? I quit my job 3 months ago because it interfered with my art. Excuse me, but how do you live? I live like a gypsy. I'm mostly dependent on my brother. Are you married? Not yet. How long do you plan to do this kind of avant-garde work? Art has no time limit. I'll do it as long as I want to. Have you ever been to a hospital and had a psychiatric evaluation? Doesn't a normal person look rather strange to an insane person? So next, the weekly Kyunghyang reported that on May 15th, 1970, Im Gurim, Jeong Chan-seung, and Bang Gaji prepared 201 envelopes mailed to two prominent critics, delivered others to literary students, and then randomly gave out the rest in front of Seoul National University. The bewildered students were told that this artistic activity was meant to expand the arts. So inside the envelopes were four small packets and a piece of paper telling them to open the packets at specific times that evening between 8:40 and 9:05. One packet contained an unidentified powder, carbamide, which is harmless and tasteless. Of course, it wasn't labeled, so they didn't know what it was. A second contained a torn condom, and another had a paper with a hole in it. So the instructions told them to do things like mix the powder with water and drink it, or take four breaths and look through the hole in the paper toward Namsan for 4 seconds. So the article says the artist's explanation was that when the viewer sees the torn condom that has lost its original purpose, their mind is open to a new dimension. The reactions of the students to this were reported to be less than positive. Today is rat control campaign day. Is this rat poison? And a student saw the torn condom and asked, is this a mockery of Ewha Women's University? I don't know what he's up to there. Most of the students went home with unpleasant expressions. So the weekly Kyunghyang also reported the next day, May 16th, the three offbeat artists continued their lonely avant-garde occupation, hanging over 100 balloons in 5 colors on the overpass in front of Shinsegae department store. The reaction of the passersby to the overpass included things like, is this a welcome balloon for Francesca Ree, who is returning home today? Are these balloons for sale? What the hell are you trying to do? And the author of the article said, I don't know what kind of breakthrough these avant-garde apostles are trying to achieve. Then, from June 7th to June 9th, the first Korean Art Prize exhibition was hosted by the Hanguk Ilbo at the National Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art, which was inside the Gyeongbok Palace. And according to Sunday Seoul, trouble started when they said they would accept creative works of all tendencies without any restrictions on standards. So Kim Gurim was officially invited and intended to exhibit 2 works. One of which was From Phenomenon to Trace D, in which he wrapped a 30-centimeter wide strip of cloth around the entire museum, dug a hole in front of the entrance, and buried the 2 ends there. He declared that since it went into the ground, it was earth art, and since it encompassed the entire museum, the artwork featured the entire Gyeongbokgung Museum of Art as 1 work. And when he submitted the work, he wrote 9 million won, the value of the building, as the price of the work. The judges ordered him to remove it, saying it made the museum look like it was wrapped for a funeral. And when he refused, the workers pulled it all down. Kim then sent the organizers a strongly worded letter of protest and vowed to file a lawsuit and claim damages for 9 million won. He had a sense of humor. Another sculpture called From Phenomena to Traces featured blocks of ice wrapped in cloth, which were to slowly melt and change shape under the cloth. But the organizers were afraid that the other works in the room would be damaged by the melted ice in the water, so they did not allow it to be exhibited. Also exhibiting as public artists, not really invited artists, were Jeong Chan-seung, seen here, and Jeong Gang-ja. So under the theme of neutral space, Jeong filled 2,000 balloons in four colors with hydrogen and oxygen and used glue to attach them to the ceiling of the exhibition hall. According to the artist, the era of art on canvas has passed. Sunday Seoul said that it looks like a sports day at an elementary school. There is no reason for conservative judges to stand for this kind of art exhibition. But the problem was the glue used to attach the balloons made it difficult to remove. You can see the glue on the balloons there. And Jeong said, well, that's exactly what I was aiming for. He claimed that the traces of my work will remain forever, and the traces are an extension of the work. Jeong Gang-ja, on the other hand, laid out more than 100 mirrors like tiles on the floor. She had planned to cover the entire floor of the exhibition hall, but due to the strong opposition of the organizers, she had to leave a section for visitors to walk through. Unfortunately, there's no photos of this. According to Jeong, the sound of the mirror breaking when the visitors step on it and the shape of the broken mirror is the work, and so therefore visitors can participate in the production of the work. So in the same issue, Sunday Seoul offered a report titled, A Performance Involving Money, Nudity, and Fighting. A nude woman wears clothes made of banknotes. A young man on stage uses an oxygen welder to glue ice cubes together. Korea's unique traditional music is modulated into psychedelia, and an audience member gets on stage for a boxing match. These outlandish shows are not shows, but artworks that will take place at the first Korean avant-garde festival that was to be held at the Drama Center in Seoul on July 3rd. And it goes on from there, and it's all very whimsical, and I mean, it never took place. So I don't know if this is just them fooling around, or if it's Sunday Seoul. This is a creative writing piece. I really don't know. So then, June 20th, 1970, at Sorim Coffee Shop in Uljiro, these artists found the fourth group. So we have Jeong Gang-ja, Jeong Chan-seung, Sonil Guang. They're some of the most active ones. At this coffee shop, they stood up, placed their hands on their chest, sang along with the national anthem, which came out of nowhere, and followed with the Pledge of Allegiance, and then began their inauguration ceremony. They read their manifesto amid soul and psychedelic music and the sounds of birds and waves, with Moktak and Brahms symphony making for the finale. Sunday Seoul reported on this and included the obligatory mention that the coffee shop customers were dumbfounded. But so here they start moving into this idea, we see it in final one, of muche, absence of body or non-corporeal entity. So this becomes a little more philosophical. And so the fourth liberates the innate state of humanity. The fourth confirms the independence of true Korean culture is the main agent of world culture. It may have been a bit ahead of their time there. The fourth unifies all systems through participation, and the fourth creates the whole as a non-corporeal entity, or muche. So the first act of the fourth group, and actually I should say they were called the provisionally titled fourth group. That was the official title, as if they didn't have a permanent name. The first act of the fourth group took place on the evening of July 1st. As the weekly Hanguk reported, two members of the fourth group, Jeong Chan-seung and Go Ho, performed a pantomime on the streets of central Seoul. So act one began in the window of the new Seoul Beer Hall next to the National Theater in Myeongdong. So Jeong, described as acting like a human monkey, was inside the beer hall behind a window and Goho pulled out a matchbox and lit a match. He brought it to the glass, and the human monkey in the window screamed to catch the flame, but the glass prevented him from doing so. Goho repeated this with bread and wine, but the monkey inside the glass couldn't reach it, so he licked the glass, but to no avail. Then an audience member rushed at Goho, snatched the wine and bread, opened the door, and threw them at the monkey. The monkey picked up the pieces of bread that had fallen to the ground and ate them, and so Act 1 ended. And the group moved to the overpass in front of the Shinsegae department store, where Act 2 began. As the overpass was narrow, it was difficult to perform in the midst of all the pushing and shoving. "Look," they said, "isn't this gruesome, dreary, skeletal overpass a beautiful piece of situational art?" Their theory was that by performing there, many people would flock to the overpass, and the overpass would look beautiful with its colorful harmony. The stage for Act 3 was in front of the National Theater, and people had lined up there to watch a play. And so the third act was called The World Goes Bang Bang, and they planned to attempt body painting. However, theater officials tried to eject them, and a scuffle ensued. The faces of most of the ladies walking by turned red when they read the slogans on their chests, because they said, "How do you prove you're a virgin, and I am looking for myself who I have lost?" Eventually, they were taken to Myeongdong police station for violating traffic laws. So they were turned over to a summary court and served 3 days in jail, during which, according to the weekly Joongang, they carried out a hunger strike. The weekly Hanguk reported a number of their statements. "In the modern era," they said, "all of us are marginalized. What is wrong with searching for the lost me in the extreme situation where there is me, but the true me cannot be found?" The virgin mentioned here is not the virgin we always think of, but only represents human purity that is being erased by modern civilization. As the weekly Joongang described it, this street theater, which was performed for the first time in Korea, was an uprising by the fourth group to make avant-garde art flourish in Korea. It then quotes the artists as saying, "There was something wrong with modern people who are stuck in a uniform stereotype. The old generation is already in a state of infinite aesthetic poverty. So they try to crush new movements with the force of majority rule. Call us crazy? That's the backward mentality of our country, where even a small deviation from habit is considered to be a great wrong. In the eyes of a crazy person, even a sane person looks crazy. It is time for our people, who are slaves to Western civilization, to realize that they are slaves to themselves. Therefore, we, the fourth group, declare the liberation of human nature. We believe in the independence of a pure Korean culture. There must be a new ism to unite the dismemberment that has been created by the separation of mind and body." So clearly, their thinking is evolving here. But in the meantime, Sonil Guang, with Sunday Soul's help, took body painting to new exhibitionist heights using lipstick and paint, with the magazine asking, "Is the designer painting a dream on the young lady's body?" And actually, this model was reasonably well known. She even appeared on a magazine cover about a month later. Then on August 15th, Korea's Independence Day, the fourth group gathered in Sajik Park and read a declaration, which began with a parody of the National Charter for Education, and then began a funeral march for the established culture and art, in which they held white flags, which represented muche, or incorporealism and pure harmony, as well as the national flag, a white coffin which contained sand and was decorated with flowers and the national flag. They intended to walk from Sajik Park to the Han River, where they could bury the coffin, but they were stopped by police near City Hall. When the police questioned the idea that the coffin was artwork and even kicked it, a confrontation ensued. And before long, a police truck took them to the Namdaemun police station, where they spent the night. The next day, they were taken to a summary court where they were admonished to behave themselves. It's safe to say they do not listen much. This is because on the August 23rd issue of Sunday Seoul, it featured an article with the following images titled, "Though human bodies are intertwined, they call the work bodiless," kind of a play on words of muche. So the article explains how a reporter accompanied the fourth group members as they rehearsed for Jeong Gang-ja's upcoming exhibition and witnessed them writhing on the floor together naked amid lights and dry ice. In the second part, Jeong wore tissue paper clothes made by Sonil Guang, something akin to this. There isn't actually a photo from 1970. And had water poured on the clothes until she became nearly naked. The article then explained her plans for exhibition, and the article ended with the author saying, "I wonder if their happening is an avant-garde or just a prank in the name of avant-garde." So a photo of her in this Sunday Seoul article was used as part of a collage on the leaflet for her exhibition. This did not last the full amount of time. It was not there for 5 days. She was profiled by Weekly Joseon in early September, where she declared, "We feel like we are suffocating. We're going to expose the old way of thinking to society." However, because the exhibition involved nudity, it was shut down after 2 days, with the government official asking, "How could that be considered an artistic act or an exhibition? I've never seen anything like it before in my life." In truth, there may not have been any nudity there. It may have been shut down purely on the basis of the photos that appeared in Sunday Seoul. And then a week later, orders from a high place, which is a euphemism for President Park Chung-hee, came down to police who, without warning, carried out the first long hair crackdown on August 29th. And since long hair had become fashionable during the past 6 months, over 600 young men had their hair cut on the first day alone. Among them was Jeong Chan-seung, who appeared on the cover of the Weekly Hanguk having his head shaved. You know, when I first came across this, I thought, wow, look at that. Like, you know, they're really, the government's really showing who's in charge here. You know, they grabbed him and put him in front of the cameras and put him on the front page, you know. But now, you know, having gone through all this material, I'm kind of wondering if he actually volunteered, you know, because there's another member of the fourth group with him. So I do wonder if this is just another kind of public act, you know, sort of a form of protest. But I really don't know. Days later, a crackdown was announced on avant-garde art, including body painting, avant-garde drama, avant-garde clothing involving excessive exposure, avant-garde film, avant-garde groups, avant-garde designers, groups of avant-garde musicians, go-go dancing, long hair on men, possession of happy smoke or marijuana, and possession of hallucinogens, probably LSD. Now, of course, most of those refer to the activities of the fourth group, right? I mean, avant-garde designers, is, the government has kind of handpicked Sonil Guang as a target. So the crackdown was therefore, you know, suppressing every kind of activity associated with the fourth group and what their members had been doing for the past 3 years. Making clear that they themselves were a target for the authorities. But one of the things they wanted to do, is they were cracking down on long hair for the next month. There was really no legal basis for this. What they did is they just walked up to you and said, you know, they took you to the police station and said, "Okay, you're going to go get a haircut." And if you said, "What do you mean?" Then they'd say, "Well, you don't have to get one. You can go to a summary court tomorrow and stay in jail overnight." So most people just comply. In some cases, the judges threw the charges out when they actually went to court, because there really wasn't a legal basis for it. And also a number, like the Kyunghyang Shinmin interviewed a bunch of academics and sort of legal professionals, and kind of uniformly, they generally said, "I don't like seeing men with long hair, but I don't think we should be using the law against them." With I think one law professor in particular saying, "Korea is a democracy and we have the rule of law, and I think the law should be generous enough to let, you know, young men have long hair." And so actually this kind of pushback stopped these attempts to criminalize long hair, and there's also a miniskirt crackdown. And So laws against them were not passed until 1973, after the advent of the Yushin Constitution. And by that point, Korea had become full-on authoritarian. But it should be noted that when that law is finally passed, and what they tried to pass here was targeting long hair and excessive exposure, which two things strongly associated with members of the fourth group. So this crackdown on avant-garde art led to the fourth group's dissolution and the disappearance of its members from weekly magazines, and served to muzzle one of the few groups that had openly called for individual freedom in an increasingly authoritarian society. And unfortunately, the 1970 crackdown on long hair and experimental art was just a harbinger of things to come. But obviously, this made things much more difficult for these artists. And as a result, they began to leave Korea. In 1972, Kim Gurim moved to Japan, where he found much more acceptance than in Korea. And both Jeong Chan-seung and Jeong Gang-ja were caught using marijuana during the 1975 marijuana crackdown. In 1975, Jeong Gang-ja moved to Singapore, where she would stay until 1982. And in 1981, Jeong Chan-seung moved to New York City. And he also spent some time in Paris. And Kim Gurim also moved to New York City in the mid-1980s. So does anyone recognize anyone in this photo? Because that's on the left there is Han Dae-soo, folk singer. And within the center with the beret is Jeong Chan-seung. So this was taken in the early 90s at Han Dae-soo's home. And so Han's second album had been banned in 1975. So he could no longer express himself artistically. So he moved to New York City in 1977. And as Han remembered of Jeong Chan-seung, "I liked his work. He was very radical and inspiring. He had a huge studio in Greenpoint, Brooklyn. And I saw a ramyun stuck to a frying pan that he'd hung on the wall." And he said, "Wow, what is this, Brother Chung?" So that's my art, my life. Ramyun stuck to a frying pan. That told the story of his life at the time. He was not a cook, and very little of his art was selling. And this photo shows Jeong Chan-seung standing, and off to the side there is Baek Nam-jun and Kim Gurim in New York City in 1985. And so, Jeong was ultimately well regarded there by artists, and he considered New York his second home. So he passed away in 1994. And in 2019, a retrospective of his work was held at the Korean Cultural Center in New York. Jeong Gang-ja returned to Korea in 1982, continued painting, and traveled the world on sketching tours. She passed away in 2017. Sonil Gwang, the designer, he currently runs an art gallery in Kapyeong, while Kim Gurim currently has a retrospective at the Museum of Modern and Contemporary Art in Gwanghwamun. A number of these artists' work has been recreated in recent years. We see here the phenomenon to traces, the triangles recreated at the museum with Kim Gurim watching. This was done a few years ago. But it took years of them being ignored before this kind of recognition came to them. So I find that when you discuss youth culture in the 1960s and 70s in Korea, people usually focus on music and fashion and university students, but discussion of the fourth group tends to be limited to art history. So hopefully tonight I've shed enough light on them to make it clear how important they were to both the expression of youth culture and, unfortunately, to its suppression. Thank you. Anyone have any questions?
Yeah, I'm interested. You've mentioned a couple of times the presentation of Kim Nam-jun. To what extent was he peripheral to, or central to, or seen as a model by people in the Hong Kong movement? And he had already, as I understand it, he'd already achieved some success and gone overseas, right?
I'm not entirely sure, but I think he was more peripheral. Because, I mean, he went, when he moved to Germany in the late 50s, and he never returned to Korea until 1984. So he was living in Tokyo and New York and in Germany. I think, of course, the artists knew who he was, and you know, being Korean helped. But I don't know, you know, how much of an influence he had. I don't think it was a strong influence.
According to the writers, but I think what the Koreans actually find it good, but certain sources that could have people, certain foreign people have been on art in Korea, or that would be a source for different schemes all the way through. He wasn't so well.
But it's interesting because the first time you mentioned him, he was brought in for an event, right?
No, he didn't actually come.
Oh, I see.
No, I guess he pledged some sort of support, you know, but he didn't come again to Korea until 1984.
Oh.
Yes.
Thank you. Great talk. Two questions. The first one, considering the cost of the riverbank project, which you said in today's money is 500,000 won and all the other various things, rather than youth culture, are we just looking at the work of some couple of rich kids that are going out spending money? And I don't know the answer, but it seems like a lot of their work cost a lot of money, involved in their production, and the normal people would not be able to produce this. So can we perhaps, and I'm also adding that they look down on one of the members of their great university. So do you have anything to say about the socioeconomic status of these artists vis-a-vis the youth culture? The second question is, despite their interests, did the work of these groups result in the conservatism of Korean culture rather than cultural liberation?
Interesting. So for the first one, I think one of the things to remember, especially at this time period, is that to kind of take part or even to be consuming a lot of the youth culture, a lot of people did not, I mean, people had radios, very few people had TVs, so you could go to places like comic book rooms or laundromats maybe, or to where there would be TVs where you could watch that kind of thing. So a lot of the youth culture, and of course buying LPs would be hugely, you know, expensive. So there was already a kind of a cost barrier. I think radio would be one of the main ways that you would be able to access it. But certainly, like, there are little bits and pieces, like Kim Gurim, like he mentioned, he's basically living on the sort of good graces of his brother. And of course, the thing, of course, to remember is going to university at that time, you know, having a university degree would be like having a PhD today. You know, you've spent, it was very expensive and it was very uncommon. So they were already, yes, kind of elite. Though, you know, Jeong Gang-ja was, the key money for her apartment came from her brother, who was reportedly a blues singer. And he had given her the 100,000 won key money for her apartment. And, but she was able, because of her, you know, art background, to teach art. And they had the figures, how much she was making, 20 or 30,000 won a month. I'd have to look at the inflation converter to work that out exactly. But I would say you're definitely talking about people of upper, yeah. And of course, even a lot of these ideas that we're discussing would be kind of beyond the cares of a lot of people at the time who were, you know, just working to live. But yes, I mean, even when, for the second question, when, did they bring about the conservatization of Korea despite working against it? I think you could make that argument. They seem to kind of court, you know, controversy and attention. And I mean, even at the funeral march, like they had the coffin and the police were like, what the hell is that? Where are you going with it? And he kicked the coffin and, you know, I guess Kim Gurim got really angry and it brought on this, you know, they were seeking a confrontation, I think. So it's not that surprising. I don't think, did anyone expect just how severe the crackdown was going to be? That they were just, with no warning, going to start grabbing young men and having their heads shaved? Probably not. Though there were examples of that happening in Taiwan and Singapore, but it probably wasn't very well known. So, but I would say that probably, yes, one of the unfortunate side effects, they did contribute to that. Yes.
Thank you for your talk. I'm curious about the mention that you talked about a few years. So, like, overwhelmed or suppressed by Western or American ideology, that a lot of them have gone to the States and gone to New York. And I'm just wondering if that's just like, that's the status quo, like, that's how things go. I want to be an artist and I want to have exposure. Or did their mentality change about the West? Did they feel like that was the place to express themselves because of the company? I mean, there you can't help but think like that kind of contradictory. If they're all about liberation and stuff like that.
No, for sure that was something that kind of shocked me when I read it, because nowhere else did they really talk like explicitly sort of criticizing the West. It's not something they really articulated. So I was kind of surprised by that. But yeah, I mean, obviously there wasn't much of a market or an audience for what they were doing in Korea. So, I mean, even someplace like Tokyo was probably more welcoming. Jeong Chan-seung said, of New York, he said, well, New York isn't American, it's cosmopolitan. So there's probably that's another reason why so many of them ended up gravitating there. But yeah, sorry, it's not a great answer, but yeah. I don't think so, no.
The term happening resurge since there like a Y2K revival that has come again when things have come.
The term
happening. So using it in that.
Right. I think that was a very 1960s term. Yeah. It's happening, man. I think it's very much kind of stuck in that time period. And of course Korea came to it a bit later than in the US, where it was started in the late 50s. Yes.
Just looking at this topic a bit. So I wonder, given the fact that performance art generally doesn't exist here, Korean Nancy Lang is an example, I don't know what the hell she does, so why she's famous. What might you have to say about the Gangnam box film?
Oh, God.
Who claims to be doing art, the maker of the box with the dreams and the hero. So that made the news. It's only performance art I've actually seen recently.
Did he motorbike
them? No. Oh, okay. Yeah. I don't know if you have any thoughts on her.
I'm just hearing of this now, so. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that comes off, maybe my reaction ends up being the same as a lot of the people who were dumbfounded at the time in the 60s. Clearly what they were doing, we can look at what was happening in the 60s now and go, because it's historical and we can see what the influences were and that's all been kind of laid out. So it's not that shocking to us, whereas the newer forms.
About her are pretty similar to the forms. Because what she keeps doing can't be
hard. Right, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's a common thing said with this kind of performance art, or with even going back to like Marcel Duchamp and the ready-mades, and He's like, well, this is art because I've decided it's art. You know, this obviously that kind of thing can be kind of alienating to some people.